Remember that I told you that we would have several different talks at this conference by mentorees of Jennifer Coelho. And Tia Luck is one more. She's a senior at Oak Grove High School in San Jose. And she will be presenting work on observations and analysis of Vietnamese text. I find it to be one of the most interesting scripts derived from Latin script, and really eager to see the talk. With the floor, Tia Luck.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for the introduction. As you've heard, my name is Tia, and I will be a senior in high school this year. Today, I'd like to present a brief overview of the history and additional observations of Vietnamese texts. So starting off, since I'm new to TUG, I'll begin by providing some background on myself. So I was born and raised in San Jose, California. My grandparents speak Vietnamese at home the majority of the time, so I've been exposed to and surrounded by this language consistently throughout my life. I actually took 10 years of Vietnamese school from the age of 6 to 16, so I know how to read, write, and speak it. Last year, I also returned to volunteer to teach younger students Vietnamese, which I'd say was a pretty gratifying experience. And I will be entering my final year at Oak Grove High School in about less than a month now. Okay. With that, let's dive straight into a brief history of Vietnamese text. So this is the Vietnamese alphabet that we know today and that I learned. However, the language did not always look this way. Okay. In fact, its origins can be attributed to heavy Chinese influence with the creation of what is called Zhuhang, or you could also say Zhunya. And under Chinese rule from around the 9th century, all writings were done in classical Chinese characters. And this was known as the official writing system of the region and of the court. It would continue to hold this position until the beginning of the 20th century, when it was replaced by a different writing system. And Zhuhang and Zhunya are actually still used often today in calligraphic banners for various traditional occasions, such as festivals, funerals, Lunar New Year's, or as you call in Vietnamese, tut, and weddings. And here's an example of what it would have looked like. And as you can see from this image, from the left and right banners are Zhuhang, they're just Chinese characters, and in the middle is what Vietnamese looks like today. Okay. Eventually, a different Vietnamese writing system evolved out of the previous. It was based on Chinese characters, which can also be considered logograms, and it's not certain when exactly this form was created, but we know that it was well established by the 11th century. What differentiates this, which is called Zhunom, from the previously mentioned writing system Zhuhang, is that it constructed new characters based off of Zhuhang for native Vietnamese words. So it essentially borrowed Chinese characters to make new words. And in the example that is shown on screen, the Chinese characters on the top left means heaven, and the one below it means above. And these are combined to make the gnome character, which is Vietnamese, which means sky. And Zhunom as a system was more difficult, and it also required that you already knew a fair amount of Chinese characters in the first place. So not many people learned it, save for some of the cultural elite who used it in their literary writings. But the primary system used for official documents remained to be Zhuhang, which you've seen on the previous slide. And even today, very, very few people exist who can actually read Zhunom. Yeah. And here is another image of some examples of Zhunom. They are more complicated than just the Zhuhang Chinese characters. And those are the Vietnamese words that are like correspond to them. And moving on to Zhu Guok Ngu. So this is the familiar script, which is used today. The Romanization of the Vietnamese writing system occurred around the 17th century when Portuguese missionaries developed it when needing to transcribe scriptures for new converts. And as the Portuguese language uses Latin letters, the same was applied to Vietnamese. So with this new development, everyone could now learn to read and write Vietnamese. Being literate was no longer so restricted to the elite or upper class, and the Latin letters have made it easier to learn. Furthermore, during French occupation in the 19th century, usage of the script became more and more popular. And finally, during French colonial rule in the 20th century, Chữ Quốc ngữ became the official writing system of Vietnam. And it was more direct and accessible than Chữ Nôm. And it also became more popular than Chữ Hán, which was just the Chinese characters. And as just as a reminder, this is what Chữ Quốc ngữ looks like. If we compare this to the English alphabet, we notice a number of differences, even though the letters are very similar because both are Latin-based. So for the Vietnamese alphabet, it excludes the letters F, J, W, and Z. And it also includes the addition of multiple types of accent marks. And I refer to these accent marks as a bowl right here, as a hat, and a hook. I'm not sure what they're officially called, but that's how I refer to them. And these change the way that the letters are pronounced, and they appear mostly on the vowels. Yeah. In addition to those accent marks, there are also these accent marks. And the first one is called a grave. And in Vietnamese, you would call it wing. And the second one is called a hook, and it's different from the hook on this slide because it's not attached to the letter. It actually sits on top of it. In Vietnamese, that would be called hoi. And then the next one is a tilde, which in Vietnamese is called nha. The next one is an acute accent, which in Vietnamese is sec. And the last one is an underdot, which goes underneath the vowel, and that is called nang. It's also worth mentioning that these marks can be used along with the others from the previous slide. And when they're combined, they can create new words and meanings. And just to emphasize how integral these accent marks are to the language and how much of a difference they can make, I have this example right here. As you can see, these are all just MA, right? The first one has no accent, so it's pronounced ma, and that means funeral. The second one has the acute accent, it's pronounced ma, and that means mother. As you can see, it's a very different definition, a very different word. The next one has a grave mark, it's pronounced ma, and it means but or nevertheless. The next one is has a tilde, it's pronounced ma, and it means horse. And the one after that has a hook. It's also pronounced ma, but it's a bit of a shorter sound than the previous. And the meaning of that is grave. And the last one with the underdot is pronounced mat, and it means a rice seedling. So as you can see, just a little change in the accent mark can make a big difference to the meaning of the word. Okay, here are some samples that I've collected to show some instances that Vietnamese text is used in the real world. Here we have a couple of pictures that I took from Little Saigon in San Jose, which is a very large Vietnamese community. As you can see, all of the letters are capitalized, they are block letters, and some are in sans, and this down here is in a sans serif font. The accent marks are visible, but they seem a little squished, small, and slightly awkward in placement. As you can see by this tilde right here, it's not exactly centered, and it's the spacing is a little off. But at the end of the day, it is still readable. Okay, next we have these restaurant signs. The words here are slightly more stylized and cursive looking. And again, the accent marks are visible, but it is still a little difficult to distinguish. Okay. Next, we have these signs. And these include a combination of capitalized lowercase letters and in different colors to emphasize some of the words. They are all in sans except for this one, which is sans serif. And in these posters, the placement of the accent marks are not actually as awkward. And I believe this to be the case because designing posters like these give more flexibility and room than when creating signage for buildings like the examples on the previous slides. And next up we have these newspapers. As you can see, there's a variety of different fonts and colors going on. It is very stylized, similar to American newspapers. Accent marks do appear somewhat small, especially for this one down here. It's quite actually just dots. You can barely see them. It is still readable though for a Vietnamese person, but I personally think it would be better if they were more prominent or larger in the designs. Okay. And finally, we have signage from Vietnam, or more specifically the city of Hanoi. There's nothing too different about these from the last ones, aside from the inclusion of Du Hang, or the Chinese characters, which are right here and here. And as you can see, they are still in use today, although they don't appear as frequently as the Latin-based Vietnamese scripts. Yeah, and that'll be all from me today. Cảm ơn, or thank you for so much for joining me, and I hope you were able to learn something. And as for acknowledgements, I'd like to thank Ms. Jennifer Claudio, who I learned about Tug through, and she has been so supportive of me these past few years, and I'd like to thank her for continuing to provide me with opportunities to grow my skills. I'd also like to thank my parents and grandparents for continually pushing me to learn and retain my Vietnamese knowledge, as this has, I feel, opened many doors for me. And finally, I'd like to acknowledge Donnie Chung for his work on Vietnamese typography. If you are more interested to see how Vietnamese like works and how that could be implemented in and supported in different fonts, you can check out his website. He does a really, really great job of displaying that. So yeah, thank you. I'll take questions. I see a raised hand.
So, can you hear me?
Yes.
We can hear you.
Hi, this is De Wei Yin. Interesting presentation. Could you go back to one of your earlier slides, and I'm sorry if I mispronounced this, but this was a slide on the Chunam characters. I believe these were the newly set of characters that were created.
Yes.
Derived from the Chinese characters. Just by the way, my background is Chinese. I am fluent in Chinese, so.
Okay.
I was just, yeah, kind of looking at this, and so most of these characters appear to have, you know, two components to them, either left or right or top and bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just looking at some of them. Let's say fourth row, the rightmost column where you have three, right? So the two characters, you have that left part with a hook over at the bottom. That in Mandarin is pronounced ba. And then, of course, the three horizontal strokes is the regular Chinese character for three. If you go to the left, the character for two The two horizontal strokes, of course, means two. The character on the left, which has a top part that looks kind of like a hook with a dot and then a square at the bottom, that's pronounced tai. So it rhymes with, I guess, what you have, or it's at least probably sounds a little bit close with hai, if that is how you pronounce it.
Yes, that would be how you pronounce it.
Yeah, and then if you go to the next one, same row, to the left, nam for year, the character, the left half of it, of course, means south, and I think you most likely recognize that. And south in, not currently in the modern Mandarin Chinese, but in old, like archaic Chinese, and also preserved in some southern dialects like Cantonese, that is actually pronounced nam. And then the right side is what means year. So it looks like a lot of these characters are composed of one part that is providing the sound or the pronunciation, and then the other part, which would be the original Chinese character that gives the semantic meaning. So I just wanted to make that comment. If you go to the second row, rightmost, for bird, the right side is the usual character in Chinese for bird. And that's actually from a pictogram of a bird. And then the left side, I guess in archaic Chinese, it would kind of sound very close to something like chim or jam or something like that. So yeah, I don't know whether you're aware of this, but I thought I'd bring this up.
No, that's a very interesting point. I wasn't aware of that. So thank you for bringing it up.
Yeah. You're welcome.
I don't know Chinese like at all. Mm-hmm. So this was new information and I appreciate it.
Yeah, I think the majority of these characters, as far as I can tell, like month, the left side means month, right side in Mandarin is pronounced shang. Mm. Right. Anyway, so just wanted to comment on that.
Very cool. Yeah.
Tia, do you know that this is a comment, not a question? Thanks very much for the beautiful presentation and learning a lot on that. but my comment is, do you know that one of the biggest advances of tech over the last 20 to 25 years was promoted by a Vietnamese guy called Han Thiet Thanh. And at the time he started working in tech, tech did not output a PDF file directly. And he was the guy that made that possible and introduced a bunch of new technologies into tech. And I guess probably some of it was driven because of the hard typography and character positioning and so forth of the Vietnamese language.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah. This engine that he developed, this tech engine that he developed, became the standard engine for use in the LaTeX world.
And wow.
In a way that we no longer, I mean, the files that we produced before, they were called DVI files, device independent files. And that's how tech was created in the late 70s. And this DVI is being literally almost given second place in the structure right now. And we all produce PDF files without even thinking about DVI files these days. It's only the tech programmer that think about this device-independent file still. And a lot of this was initiated and finished by this particular guy, Han Thiet Thanh. Let me ask you a question. Do you have any diacritic marks still in your own name?
In my own name?
Yes.
In Vietnamese, I have an under dot on my last name, under the U.
Under the U. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. And the Tia doesn't have any accents at all.
No, the Tia does not have accents, no.
Is it normal for an American to just Americanize it and take all the accents out? And then...
I see Tia is just, it's not a Vietnamese name. I do have a Vietnamese name. It's pronounced Tu Linh. And that does have marks on the U for the T-U. It has an acute mark on the U.
Okay.
But Tia is just a name that my parents named me. It's not Vietnamese.
Cool.
Yes.
Cool. Well, thanks for the wonderful lecture.
Hey, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.